Hello, everyone. Welcome to another Monday Mix Tank. My name is Mark Abrams, and I'm with Puremix.net. If you're joining us on YouTube or Facebook for the first time, this is Mix Tank, where I go live every Monday, and we take a listen to mixes from the Puremix pro member community, where they can submit their mixes and get feedback from everybody. People try to leave helpful comments and help get a mix across the finish line if somebody's struggling with anything. So that's what I'll be doing today, is listening to mixes live. Couple announcements for housekeeping before we get started. This Friday, we have an amazing video from Andrew Sheps coming out called Compression Typology. And in this video, Andrew explains all of the different types of compressors, like VCAs, FETs, everything that you could wonder about, mute compressors, everything. And then he'll go through and explain different controls with them, what their unique characteristics are, and give some sound examples as well. So that video comes out Friday. Keep an eye out for it. And then up on the horizon, we have an amazing video from Michael Brower coming out. It's going to be the first time that Michael has shown his Browerize technique. So if you were following Michael Brower in the early 2000s and beyond, he was mixing all analog on an SSL. And he had these towers that were famous. They were compression towers, and he had amazing outboard gear in them. And one of the things he would do is he would use each one of those parallel buses. He had four parallel buses, and he would use them for different batches of instruments and the different compressors for all of the different elements that they would bring out in the mix, so like mid-range, all those kinds of things. But as things transitioned into the box, everybody was kind of trying to recreate this, and it was impossible due to latency reasons and some other things. But he and his assistant have found a way, and we made a video about it. So that's coming to Puremix no later than very soon. We also have a Snarky Puppy series coming for the recording of their new album, Empire Central, which comes out September 30th. So keep an eye out for that. It's a pretty epic thing. We did like a 2-hour documentary of the recording process. There's going to be a mixing video for stereo and a mixing video for Atmos. So that's going to be pretty cool. To start these off, I like to give a track that I've been listening to and that I love, that has some really cool things that I think we can all bring to our next mix. And this one is one of my favorite mixes, really, probably of all time. I really love this one. This is a track called Muddy Waters from the artist LP. And bunch of stuff I love in this mix, so I'll just kind of talk through it, but you guys can go check it out. I put a link in the YouTube chat for you to take a listen to. And awesome. So yeah, right off of the top of this one, it opens up with a tambourine that's kind of in some reverb, and it's very sparse, but there's also something cool to listen to when you kind of go through it with a fine-tooth comb, and that's that you actually hear some bleed, where it's just this tambourine intro in the first couple bars. You can hear the hum thing that happens later. There's like some bleed going through a reverb, or something was going through the console, and you can kind of hear it like buried in there. So that's always fun to find those things. I love this mix because of probably the biggest reason is all of the depth that it has. So front to back. So like if the singer's here, what's happening here on what I call like the back wall. This has some of the most gorgeous sounding reverbs in it. And everything seems to have its own space and its own depth. And it's a great lesson in something needs to be far away for something else to feel close. And her lead vocal feels extremely close because of all of the painting that's kind of done on this back wall. So that's something to listen to. The reverb tails especially kind of tell you where the back of the room is if you're listening on stereo. So there's some other treatments on the vocal that are awesome. There's a lot of mono delay stuff happening that's really cool, and it also serves to kind of put a anchor around the center of the image so that when things are happening on the outside, they feel wider without using a whole lot of trickery. It's just because of the focus on the center of the image that allows things that happen on the sides to feel more like moments and kind of paint out how wide it is. At 125, the low end drops, and it is deep. So another thing I'll use this as a reference for, in addition to depth, is the low end balance of a speaker system. So if I'm going into a studio I don't know, this is one of the tracks where I know it so well on my monitors that if I listen on other speakers, I can kind of figure out what's going on in the room. So be that with like the stereo image or the low end. There's a yell vocal that happens. It's in mono. And it kind of goes on I think it starts on the right and then it'll happen on the left. And it sort of shows you where the edges of the image are. So where the sides of the canvas are. As it goes into verse two, there's a down chorus before verse two. So pretty light. on the instrumentation. And then verse two starts to bring up some more elements and kind of build us up as we're going through the song. But it's also a lesson in minimalism, because there's not a whole lot happening here. There's not a lot of like patty things happening, giving us the chord structure and everything, but they start to add these elements in as it goes. And when we get to pre-chorus two, everything strips back again in order to make room for this gigantic chorus that happens all the way at 210. So the big apex happens like pretty deep into the song on chorus two. But at that point, it just explodes because there's been all of this different, you know, kind of up and down in the energy graph of the song going from section to section. In that chorus, the kick that happens has a powerful mid-range to it that it's not worried about being overly subby. It's just kind of giving a lot of attack. I mean, it's thick and it's powerful, but it's not worried about the very bottom of the range, which is happening from some of the 808 stuff that's in there and some other elements. In the bridge, everything kind of goes down again after this huge chorus because we want to be able to get back up on the last chorus. So on bridge, it's a stripped down bridge. And to get there, there's a cool stereo delay that happens on her voice as it leads out. And this is another thing I use it for references on because I suffer from a disease called too quiet in the bridge. Usually on bridges or like down choruses like this, when things get stripped away, I'll almost overdo it sometimes and lose energy going into that, and it'll be a lot quieter than the rest of the song. And then I've had things like get to mastering, and then it's like, oh, I need to go back and kind of bring things up in that section so it doesn't feel like the bottom fell out and we lose all the energy. So these stereo delays kind of bring us down into that and make it feel like it's still as present as it was before, even though we're quieter and we're making room for things to build back up again. So yeah, the transitions just going from section to section, I like to call them scene changes sometimes, and they're just done so well in this mix that this one, this serves as a really good reference for that. So everything goes away and then boom, the last chorus hits. It's somehow bigger than the one that happened at 210. And the lead vocal in the choruses, I think, is worth noting that it's actually pretty dry because there's so much reverb and other things happening inside of the song that it lends itself to just kind of be the dry anchor in the center of the mix while like giving us context for all the other stuff. If I have one gripe about this mix, it's at the very end, as she says the last line when it goes out, it's almost like there's an edit or like a mouth kind of click in there that probably could have been cleaned up like easily, but it's also a reminder to me of like, sometimes that stuff can pull you away from what's going on in it, but that's like the smallest gripe in the world. This is a Rob Kanelsky mix. Rob also mixed the Billie Eilish record that was huge, and I believe has mixed all their stuff. And it feels very, very different than the Billie Eilish stuff, which is another fun thing if you're doing research on like what is a mixing engineer's style, if you're kind of going through their discography. This one shows you like it's got a lot of awesome tricks, and I think that Rob always does this amazing job of making all this depth inside of a mix, like I was pointing out earlier. He does that in the Billie Eilish stuff as well, but this one is much more hi-fi and just huge, and to me the bottom end is perfect. So I use this as a reference track for low end, for depth in the image, and then also how wide the stereo image is whenever I go to different rooms. So check that out. That's Muddy Waters from LP. I think it's a great tune, and I hope you guys check it out and dig it as well. Okay, so let's go over to Mixtank. And if you haven't seen it before, this is Mixtank. On the left, we have a bunch of cards that are different mixes from different members. Then we have our timeline, which you can think of like SoundCloud if you use that. So users can drop timestamped comments throughout the song saying like, I think the vocal should come up here and stuff like that. Over on the far right, we've got information about the song. So we've got the username, their level of self-proclaimed expertise there. We've got track status. This one that's on the screen right now says advanced mix. So it kind of tells us where the user feels like the mix is at and what stage they're at. Sometimes it'll say masters. Sometimes it'll say rough mix. They can choose that as they submit the mix. And then we've got some notes from them. So we're going to start off with this one from Jay Allen. This is called How Does It Feel? And he says, hi there, this tune is nearing completion. I'm wondering what's lacking in the mix. Are there any obvious issues with the usual stuff, balance, EQ, compression, that I'm missing? I do feel like it's lacking a bit of dynamic range, so I'll try and add some more with fader automation. I'm fairly happy with it for what it is, but they always benefit from fresh ears. This one's coming out very soon, so any help would be appreciated. Cool, let's dive in. So I'm gonna hit play here, And then as we go, the way that I'll kind of do this for people who are joining, or if you're hoping to have your mix listened to today, we have a draw a track button up here. So I'll do those. But if you're in the YouTube chat, please let me know that you're here. Let me know if you have a song in there. So drop your Puremix username and the name of the song, and then we'll try to hit it before the end of the stream today too. So I'd like to definitely thank everybody that shows up here and is a part of the stream. So, and also you guys in the chat too, drop your comments. They're being shown in the stream, and that's useful when people go back later to watch to hear some other opinions besides mine, just yapping into a camera. So cool. All right, let's do it. How does it feel, Jay Allen? love it, man. Great track. What a way to start the show. That's awesome. Really, really cool vibe to that whole thing. That feels great. A couple of things. I'll just point out the first one right here at the end. We've got some lingering guitar noise and some stuff like that. That's just kind of right at the end there, just trailing off. So you could do some editing, do some fade outs on those tracks to kind of get rid of that and just let that synth thing that's happening be the ending moment of the bloom out on it. That's awesome though, man. This is a really cool track. Okay, so from the start, I'm gonna remember to put my little comment in here. So I'm putting this on all of the videos just to say that I was here, and then here's a link to watch the video. First thing I noticed was kind of in the drums. So I wanted to feel some more rhythmic push from the kick drum. So that could just be done with some more punch, also some EQ stuff. It feels like it could use maybe a little bit more snap without being clicky, cutting out a little bit of the low mid stuff to let some of the other frequencies that the kick is speaking at kind of come through a little bit. So I'd check out like for any kind of buildup that's happening around 80 or 100, any of the like, you know, low mid stuff, 200, all that, you know, kind of look around and see if there's some stuff in there that's not really helping the cause, but just kind of adding some mud. So yeah, I just wanted to kind of like feel the beat of the drums a little bit more. The snare feels good to me. It could maybe use some space. It might be a hair hot in the mix, but we'll come back to that in a second when we talk about the vocal. And then for tracks like this, it sounds to me like the drums are electronic and sampled, something that can help to kind of sell them a little bit more, and suspend disbelief would be to just add a little bit of a room around them. I love Oceanway, Studios room from UAD for this stuff. The IK Multimedia, the Sunset Sound and the Fame reverbs are both really awesome. Just kind of like room reverbs to just kind of add some space around it. That doesn't mean like you have to blow up the room mics and make them, you know, super, super roomy, but it would just kind of add a little bit of a acoustic space around them to make it congeal a little bit and feel like they all happened in the same, same space. The ride cymbal was sticking out to me just a hair, but it also has some clarity to it. And some of the other things I'm going to mention, might make that feel okay too. So I'm going to talk about some EQ stuff and some of the other instruments. And if that was addressed, then the ride might be more in context. So overall, I felt like it could use some mid-range definition on a bunch of different elements in there. So the bass guitar, for example, sometimes boosting around like 800 hertz or 1.6, like an octave up from that, will give you a little bit more definition from the strings and from some of the notes that are happening in there. You don't want to go like overly bright and make it clicky, obviously, for any of this stuff, but that would help kind of add some definition to the articulation that he's doing. The guitar solo, I felt like that could come a bit forward with some EQ. And with that kind of stuff, I've been really into the API 550 lately. You can find all kinds of different plugin versions of that. But basically just kind of looking around at the different EQ points and kind of boosting to see which one of those will, again, like just help that instrument speak a little bit and come alive. So I think that that guitar solo could benefit from a little bit of mid-range, like, you know, 1.5, 3K, like somewhere in there without making it like overly bright and painful or anything like that, but just kind of letting that thing, like some of the transient information, speak a little bit better. The BGVs, the call and answer ones in verse two, I thought that those were really awesome. And I kind of wanted them to be more of an event and like wrap around me a little bit. The lead vocal, super important. And I love like the singer's awesome on this. The performance is great. It felt like it had some 300 build up to me that would get woofy at some points, but it was also just kind of masking some of the other things happening with it. And I think if you boost some of the other stuff that's happening in the vocal for clarity, it might make the 300 thing not that, you know, big of a deal, because the rest of the signal, you know, if we're, you know, looking at a Pro Q, I'm trying to find the right hand gesture here. If we kind of did one of these, it would be more balanced, even if you didn't bring down the 300. So some like, you know, sometimes like 4K will be cool on a vocal. There's a point where it's going to be too much and you want to go back, you know, a little bit from there. And some like top end on the vocal might add some clarity to it too. Yeah, overall, that was kind of true for a lot of the different instruments, like that guitar solo and some of the different guitars that happen. Like, there's a melody one at 3:30 that comes in, and it's at that moment it's providing all the melody, but it felt a little bit kind of muddled to me. So increasing some mid-range on that might help out as well. And then the na-na-nas that happen around 3:45, same thing. I wanted those to be like a big event. That's the apex of the song right there for me, and I felt like those could be a bigger thing. So I didn't the dynamics thing. Some of that kind of feels par for the style to me a little bit. But yeah, like doing fader automations always going to help that, and especially like with telling, if you approach it from like just I want to inform the ear or the listener to what they're supposed to be listening to at this moment of the mix. Like, this is the most important thing, and giving that a little bit of a nudge will help kind of direct the ear in different ways. So it feels great though, and I think you're super close. Great production, great song. Great job, and good luck with the release. I hope it goes well. And if you submit another mix, make a comment here and I'll come back and check it out. But yeah, great job. So let's see what the chat has to say. Good to see a lot of the usual suspects in here. Really cool comments going on. So, yeah, cool. We got good ones from A Music. Mike Conway has some suggestions in there. Prime Time. Oh yeah, the sax. How could I not mention the sax? The sax is amazing. Great addition to the song. That was a nice surprise at the end, along with like the synth outro that happened. That, giving you a reason to kind of get to the end of the song is like everything. So that's awesome, and it doesn't feel like you're just hearing the same thing again, which I love. So again, great production. Let's see. Nice. Karen added a song, Do the Otter. Cool. Glad you got one in this week, Karen. That's awesome. And Prime Time's in here. Sweet. All right, let's go to our next track here. So I'm gonna hit actually let's I can't wait to listen to this Karen Bassett song. So we're gonna do one from the chat. Do the Otter. If this is the dance, I'm not going to be good at it. Okay, let's see here. I don't see anything in the timeline, but we'll just hit play. So, okay, this one's from Karen Bassett. She says, "Here's a song I mixed, played drums, keys, percussion, and sang backups on. Local singwriter or singer-songwriter Johnny Angel Wendell and the Fabulous Knuckerholes." All right, let's check it out.
The otter, yes, he does the otter. My alma mater, yes,
Welcome back, Cotter does the otter. Did I catch that right? That is amazing. I love it. What a cool song. Nice job, Karen. That's great. Nice. And you played a lot of the stuff on this. Looks like everything. Very cool. Okay. Couple comments on it. I don't have a ton. This is really cool. It felt really good. Nice. Welcome back, Otter. That's awesome. Yeah, it feels very B-52s like. 60s meets the B-52s vibe, says Martin Gavel. The Ooh is sponsored by Twist and Shout. Talking Heads, nice. Cool. Okay. Chat room's loving it. All right. Very cool. Okay, so there's a comment from Benjamin Zahavi. Sorry if I'm mispronouncing, but he says it misses bass. So I had a note about the bass guitar, and that was that I was losing some of the notes as you went from string to string. So that can sometimes be like a pickup, you know, setup kind of thing, right? Like if the pickup is, if you got your strings up here and the pickup is doing one of these, you're not going to hear as much. It's further away from some of the other strings. So as you're moving around, I was losing some of the notes in the bass guitar. Since you've already recorded it, that could be solved probably with some compression. So just kind of evening things out as you're moving around the neck and all that. Could also be the performance and the way that the guy played it too, or that you played it. So just something to check out. Maybe compression would help that out. Speaking of compression, though, I hear a lot of compression on the track overall. I'm not sure if that's coming from the stereo bus or like a limiter that might be on the stereo bus, but everything does feel very hyped and very kind of like loud and aggressive to me. And I'm wondering if like a more chill vibe might lend itself to the song a little better. And if we increase the dynamic range by removing some of that compression or limiting, it would also allow some of the elements to have more of a definitive space to them. So instead of everybody being kind of loud all the time, it would let there be kind of like layers to the track, if you will. So maybe check out some of that stuff first. In terms of the drums, they're really, really exciting, especially when the track came on. I was like, oh, this is crazy. In a good way, it was like exciting. But the kick feels out of style for me. It's almost like it has I wouldn't even say Metallica, because it's got more low end than a Metallica sample, but like a metal sample kind of thing, like a really aggressive rock kick drum with like some scoop mids and a lot of beater and a lot of sub on it. And something more style appropriate might blend well here. It pushes and like the punch of it is cool. So you got to find something that'll still give you that excitement from it, but it feels a little bit out of the genre to me. Maybe the drums are a little bit hot, but this could also be an artifact of like a lot of stereo bus compression or limiting. So again, reducing some of that might make the drums sit better, but I would maybe play around with like how loud the drums are. And it's also about deciding like who's important in the song. We have, it's not necessarily like a children's song, but my son started school today. So I'm thinking about children's songs today quite a bit. But so let's say it was a children's song. A lot of times like that vocal needs to be, children's song or not, the vocal should be really up front, because there's so many funny lyrics and everything happening in here that I think like everybody else could kind of come back in the mix a little bit and just make room for some of those vocals. And we don't want anybody to lose the fact that you did a Welcome Back Cotter reference in this. That's amazing. So the other thing was it feels very wide to me. So I don't know if there's some stereo widening going on, but things feel very spread out. The drums feel like they have an LCR panning to them, which is cool and is really awesome for a lot of stuff. I've mentioned on the show before, I like to like leave room on the sides for things like reverbs or background vocals that I want to make events for, that kind of thing on the sides of it. And a lot of times that contrast of something appearing on the outside will make the mix feel wide as well. So I don't hear like necessarily a lot of the phasey stuff that I've talked about in the past on here with that, but it does feel extremely wide to me. So that might be something to look at. But yeah, great track. I really don't have a whole lot to add other than that. Once you kind of release some of the compression and stuff, I don't know if some things like vocal compression will ease up a little bit. I was hearing, a lot of vocal compression. It kind of has that like Blue Stripe 1176 aggressive attack sound to it, which totally fine, but it did feel like there wasn't a lot of movement in the vocal dynamically. Like if you sing notes quieter, it wasn't kind of like dipping back at all and all of that. So yeah, maybe some more dynamics on it and some of that other stuff. And I think it's going along great though. Great job, Karen. That's awesome. A lot of really good stuff happening in the mix too. And you've done a lot of work on that. So very cool. Thank you as always for being here. It's awesome. And I'm so glad that we got to hear one of your tracks. I'm going to put my comment in here. Karen says, mixed by the drummer, me. Nice. That's awesome. You got to turn them up then. So cool. Okay. So Benjamin is also in the chat. So let's hit Benjamin's mix real quick. So Altered Minds, it only makes you stronger. All right. Altered Minds, it only makes you stronger. Okay, cool. All right, this looks loud, so everybody watch your speakers. And I'm going to hit play in 3, 2, check your speakers. Here we go. We'll be right back. Awesome. Cool. Nice job, Benjamin. That was sweet. I hope you like my lights. Very cool. Okay. Let's see what we got going on here. Yeah. I love this track. Really good feel. Very cool. Karen says, I feel like Benjamin made up for the lack of bass on Do the Otter with this track. Nice. Very cool. Okay. Just looking at one other thing. So you said that you make club music. It's a different style. I actually wrote a... didn't put in the mid bass, and the fading of the box could be better. Yes, cool. I read that. And all right, let's see. So one, we're gonna go back to draw a track in a minute. I'm just trying to hit some mixes for people that are in the chat. So if you have a mix one, drop it in the chat and let me know, because I want to make sure I get to the people that showed up today too. But yeah, we're gonna go back to draw a track in a minute. All right, cool. Wimad Salad says, great track. Feel like the claps are just a little too filtered. Yeah, I would, agree with that. And then here's some other comments I got. So, I love the vibe of this. I love, the style and, just it painting a picture and going into a bit of a trance state, and especially love what you did with the city ambience that comes up there. It like really kind of paints a picture and puts you in this emotion, especially with like the delivery of the vocal. That sells the emotion of the track to me, and it, paints it well. And the only thing I'd say about that, this is more of an arrangement thing, is I wonder if we should hear that earlier, because it it really adds a vibe to it and tells me what's going on. So yeah, I almost want to hear that earlier, but that's maybe not necessary and not the topic right now. So you had some other comments over here. So what do you think about the vocals and synth? How do you like the kick and bass relationship? Do you like the sound of percussion? Your fade comment, and then missing mid bass, don't really hear the bass on phone speakers, so we'll talk about that. And then you are in a new room, you said too, so that's always fun. I'm trying to figure that out, so I my heart goes out to you. Okay, so I'll just go through some of the comments that I had. Stream of consciousness as I was listening was I felt like the pad could use a little bit of excitement, even a little bit of widening, but not with like just cranking up like a stereo widener on like a BrainWorks plugin or something. The way I like to do this is with I use either Microshift or like the Dimension D Chorus. Bunch of different manufacturers make the Dimension D one. Sound Toys makes Microshift. Or you could use some kind of like pitch shifting chorus thing in your DAW. Or like a H910. So all of these things have like delays and choruses kind of built in, that they're, the Microshift is built a little bit around the H910 thing. And what happened with that unit was, what was going on in the left channel and the right channel would kind of go out of sync from time to time. And that box had a really unique sound to it because of that. Those things are doing more like delay and chorusy kind of things versus just like, you know, turning up the sides of the signal. So a lot of times I'll do like a send to a Microshift or a Dimension D or whatever, or delays, like really short delays, and just kind of push that up until I get some more width and excitement out of it. Distortion's also cool for that, but not like putting a rat pedal on it, but some like harmonic enhancement. You mentioned that you have Sugar. Sugar's distortion can be really cool for that, and play around with the different distortion types in it. Around 1 minute or so, there's an arpeggiated synth that comes in. And I love the way that you have the delays and reverb kind of blooming out after the line. Thought that was really, really well done. So I love that. The bass, I felt a little bit of the same thing with the Microshift Dimension D kind of trick, widening it up a little bit. But let's talk about the phone bass thing a little bit. So you're, the inability to hear it on small speakers is from a lack of mid-range in the bass. So there's a lot of sub-information that's going on inside of this guy, but there's not a lot of stuff that's happening in the mids, you know, around like the, on a bass guitar, like I was saying, 800, 1.6. And a lot of times I'll look at those frequency points for synth or sub bass as well. And if I can't get it by pushing some EQ, I'll add in some saturation. So if Sugar isn't working, FabFilter Saturn or really any distortion plugin like that, you can kind of blend in a little bit or do a parallel of it. And I'm not talking again about like crazy, you know, metal leading distortion or something like that, but just some saturation to get some harmonic content happening in that area. will kind of help it poke out on small speakers and add a little bit of definition to it. It'll also help us hear the note transitions a little better, and I feel like this would benefit a lot from that. Around 2 minutes and 10 seconds, you had some like side chaining, kind of pumping feeling stuff happen on LFO stuff, like on a lot of different instruments. And I felt like the modulation between like the bass and I think there was like a string sample in there. It felt like they were not in sync with each other and the grooves were fighting each other a little bit. And with the style of music, the groove is everything. It has to feel like it's all tight and together. And the groove is like really pushing you through the song. So if some of those elements are a little off from each other, you could have one guy that's like dipping out really quick, but it's got a tail of another guy coming up right over top of it. And the groove doesn't feel like they're going, you know, moving in and out together. And they start feeling like they have a little bit of a, I have weird hand gestures for this stuff, I know, but they feel like they're fighting a little bit and like a, almost like a band that's not very tight. So I thought I heard some stretching in the string sample as well. So I take a look at that. That could be causing some of the modulation fighting stuff. As far as kick bass relationship. So I think that you did a great job of arranging them around each other. You know, the bass stops playing when the kick's happening and all that. And that's all really well done. And like the side chaining's working to work with that. Level wise, I thought that the kick and bass were well balanced together. But there was a little bit of a hang in the kick that was still present when the bass was playing. So again, with the groove thing, the kick feels a little bit lengthy. And I don't think that it's a thing you have to deal with like the actual sample. I think it was kind of like an EQ thing that was happening. So it almost feels like the low end of the EQ, like when you boost that up, low end takes a longer time to dissipate. And it feels like the low end was just kind of like hanging on or blooming. And that was, again, kind of like not letting that kick bass groove be as tight as it's programmed or arranged to be. So I would watch out for the subs just kind of lingering on a little bit too long down there. And it might be just a hair too much of whatever you're boosting in the sub range. So if you bring that down, see if it just kind of grooves better and feels better. A lot of times, like when I'm EQing low range like that, like low sub stuff, I'm not necessarily even listening for the sub. I'm listening to the relationship in the groove of the bass guitar and the kick drum or something like that. Like if it's too beefy and too boomy at the bottom, it's kind of just lingering over the next note. So watch out for that, for the length of the kick drum. And when you're getting to know your room, that stuff is so hard. It's really, really hard. Headphones can kind of help out for some of that. But yeah, like just whatever's going on down there, just tightening that up a little bit. High pass filters can help and all that. But first, look at whatever you're boosting and just see if you brought that back a hair, if the groove feels any better. Yeah, so we talked about the mid bass thing. When we get to the city noise around 4 minutes, I almost wanted that to be busier and less like wind static noise and more of like the car honking and stuff and the city bustle that's happening. And that gives me the, I don't necessarily know what the song's about, but I had this picture going on in my head because of the vocal performance. It's like a guy walking through the city, kind of like sad. And it put me in that spot when we got to that moment. I just wanted to hear more of the city noise. So it was more apparent that that's where we were. As far as the vocal goes, I really loved how it feels bit crushed. That was a really cool texture. On the very top of it, there's a sizzle to it that I felt like that could go away and it would sell that filtered, verbed out kind of tone that you have going on, the distorted lo-fi tone, if it lost a little bit of that very top end sizzle to it. I don't think you'd lose any clarity in the vocal. It's just kind of like some sizzle that's happening from the distortion up top that makes it feel less lo-fi than it could. And I think it's just kind of noise stuff that you might be able to get away with lopping off. So on when you say I was there by your side, you have a every once in a while I was hearing like a verb or a delay that was going on there, and you could almost make more of a moment out of that subtly, where maybe you do like a quarter note delay to that goes into a reverb and you hear like the side thing kind of lingering after that. The ARP synth that happens at the end felt really mono to me. So again, like that trick with like a micro shift or Dimension D or some kind of delay chorus thing to just kind of widen it up might be cool. And then the groove of the vocal with the bass at the end. So the bass still has its like LFO thing happening. It's pumping. And the vocal needs to be super in time to sell that. So just watch out for the timing of the vocal at the end on the edit. And then I was also hearing the edit of the vocal sample. So it's entrance and exit. Just watch for those. Make sure that it's not obvious that the vocal is like on now or like unmuted now. You can make those entrances of that sample be a little bit more under the radar, if you will. So yeah, great track though. I love the track. Great job, Benjamin. And yeah, let me put my comment on here and I hope it's useful. That was one I copied, so Mark was here. Here we go, here's my graffiti. All right, awesome. Let's see, so I want to just check out the YouTube chat real quick, see who's got stuff in here. Juan, I'm gonna do the draw a track thing now. So we'll do that. Oh, One Man Salad said the bass is a little off tune too. I did hear a tuning thing once in a while, so check out for that. Karen says, "Can a bass be out of can a synth bass be out of tune?" And absolutely, there's a lot of fine tune things on those synths too. Like this Prophet back here, I have to turn it on and then kind of wait like 10, 20 minutes sometimes for everything to kind of warm up so that it's not modulating in pitch all the time, and then after that, I've still got tuning on there, and there's actually like some auto calibration stuff built in to put the oscillators in tune. But yeah, especially with analog synths, it can do that. Okay. Yeah, great comments in the chat. And Jacob is here with the perfect band again. Awesome. That's great. And I saw Dark Rose is here too. I think it was Carl Gibson, if I'm not getting the name wrong. Yeah, Carl Gibson's back with Dark Rose. So we're going to hit those too. But we'll do a draw a track button for Juan here. And Juan, do let me know if you got a mix in there and we'll get to it. So let's do a draw a track. Here we go. Let me take altered off of there. All right, we got leftovers from Snurd. I love the username. Okay, Snurd says, here's a song I mixed, played drums, keys, percussion, sang back. Hey, wait a minute. That's Karen's comment. Let me click on this. All right, the user stuff didn't update. Let's just check out the track. Here we go. Try that. Here we go. That's the Otter track. Let me just type that in. Strange things are afoot over at Mixtank. Let's see. Leftovers from Snurd. Here we go. He says, oh, hi, Mark. Nice. All right, Snurd. Let's see. You're probably like one of my friends in real life. Just punking me right now or something. Here we go.
Bye.
Okay, again, just first thing I'm gonna say. There's like a little pop there that could probably be cleaned up, a messy track, so, you know, do as you will. This is awesome. I love the performance, and man, the vocal is super cool. And that reminds me, this is like a cardinal rule that you don't like do this in sessions really, but this reminds me of another song or a band called Destat. That was mixed by Vance Powell that I love, but the vocal especially, like, it feels like that guy, and it's like the delivery is killer. So this is super cool. Oh, sweet. Ian's in the chat. Okay, so this is from Ian Lozinski. And yeah, this is great. Cool. Glad you're here. That's awesome. Thanks for joining. Okay, so yeah, I love the track, and I think like everything's kicking. So I'll start off with like the kick bass kind of relationship. I feel like there's a lot of kind of like 80 to 100 build up. Like things are just kind of muddy in that range. It's just super common. random nerd tip. If you're in America and mixing in a bedroom, most of our bedrooms have 8-foot ceilings in them. And what happens with room acoustics is usually at the halfway point of any dimension in the room. So if the ceiling is 8 feet, the point would be, you know, halfway, 4 feet. That's where the first axial mode will kind of appear and rear its head. And same thing with like the length of a room or the width of the room. And with the height of the room thing, the reason an 8-foot ceiling is a problem in America is most of our ears sit almost exactly at 4 feet off of the floor when we're in a chair at a desk. So most desks are, that's about like the natural height that it positions your ear at. And usually there's a giant trough that happens around 80 to like 110, 120. And if you do anything like Room EQ Wizard or anything that measures your room, like Fuzz Measure from Rode, which I think is a free program now, that's Fuzz Measure if anybody wants to get nerdy. If you shoot your room, a lot of times you'll see that dip happening right there at the listening position. So it's really easy to not clean up that area because you don't really know, because it's got a 10 dB dip in it. And that's actually not an exaggeration either. Like that can be a 10 dB dip that happens inside of that mode. So that comes up a lot. Like, I know I see like Tom Foolery's comments a lot. Like he talks about that range a lot, and stuff that he hears. And, I talk about it down here too. Like it's a problem area because of the natural acoustics of rooms there. And of course, that's why it's so hard to get the bass right in many rooms. It's just mode stuff that's happening. So yeah, I just feel like we need a little cleanup in that area. Check it out on headphones. If things are feeling, you know, kind of muddy to you in the low range, like almost sub range, just check out that area and see if you can clean it up a little bit between those two instruments. I think I'm hearing it primarily in the kick. But yeah, it could be in both. The snare drum felt like it could have some more smack, but that would kind of depend on the relationship to the vocal. So it felt a little muddy to me, a little dark, like it could use a little bit of crack, you know, from just opening up an EQ there, like 4K-ish, you know, 2K to 4K kind of area to just get a little bit more smack out of it. But the way that it is right now lets it sit behind the vocal. And I think that vocal performance is really selling the song, and it needs to, you know, still sit where it is. So just watch out if you brighten that snare up, watch out for the volume level and the relationship of it to the vocal, because it could very easily, from adding some smack, it could start like going from being back here to starting to like peak in front of the vocal a little bit. The guitars are the area of the track that I think could use some attention. And the biggest thing that I hear with them is that they're very diffused and spread out. So it sounds like there's like some delay trickery going on to give a single performance a double tracked feel to it. Let me know in the chat, since you're here, if I'm wrong about this. But this like, you know, method of spreading a guitar, like adding a double track thing, can get really washy sounding. And if I were producing the track, I'd say like, let's double those guitars. Anytime you want them to be wide like that, do a natural double of it, and you know, try to change something in the signal chain, like different guitar, different pedal, different amp, anything that can kind of add some difference to that to that performance. You could play it the exact same, just change some stuff in the chain, and that's going to make it feel nice and wide without feeling washy. It'll have a little bit more definition, and it'll also create some more room in the center for everybody else to live. The width that's being added to the bass guitar is a little bit distracting to me since it's a bass, and it's just kind of making everything kind of bloom out and feel sort of diffuse and out of focus. So check out whatever's going on with the widening on the bass. And then maybe I wanted to hear some more hair on it. So I know there's a bit of distortion on there. So before you reach for distortion, see if you can get some more mid-range out of it. Again, like I really like 800, 1.6, like those two ranges are really good spots to look for more clarity in the bass. That's a Vance Powell trick that I learned from him, and it works out wonderfully. The background vocals that are yelling Casanova, I wanted to hear those more clearly, and it felt like they should be a moment. Like that's a like cool lyric, and the thing that happens there, like that would really support the background vocal. I think that could be a thing. So maybe some more clarity there, just making that more of a thing. I think it's a bit compressed overall. It felt like something was soaking up the snare transient, but the kick was not feeling like it was getting compressed. So it almost feels like there's like a sidechain high pass on like an SSL bus compressor would be like the way that I would do that if I was going for that vibe. Like it's clamping down on everything but the kick. So just check out the compression overall on the song. If you have drum bus compression or snare compression or something like that, it could use a little bit more transient. So it feels like it's just kind of soaking that stuff up. You could also try just slowing the attack down. The vocal feels a little bit thin to me, but it's supposed to. I get that like as well. But I wonder if it had just a little bit more body, if that would help it out. You could try a Pultec, but the MEQ5 instead of the EQP1 does mid-range stuff. And sometimes you can add a little bit of 200 to a thin vocal and just make it naturally feel a little bit bigger without like feeling boomy or like it's too hi-fi or too big. So check that out, or you know, whatever EQ you have will be great. The BGV Oz at 245 are a super cool element, and they're a new thing that happens in the song at 245, and I want you to hear those more. So make more of an event out of those as well. The guitar solo I felt like could come up and it could use a little bit of clarity. So same thing there, make an event out of it, even if it's only for a bar or two, because I think the vocal came back in shortly after that. And then I heard some timing things at 3 minutes. And other than that, I was going to talk about, I got the widening on guitars already and the end pop we talked about at the first. So let's just listen to the thing at 3 minutes and let me see if I can give you some more insight on what I heard there. Yeah, so just watch out for like scoop guitars there, but I was hearing it in the performance of the main melody guitar that's happening there. Again, I want that to come up, but maybe you don't even need to worry about it because it's got a punk vibe to it and it's supposed to be, you know, kind of raw like that. So you can check it out though. I guess I heard it on the first time. So cool. Thank you for submitting that. That was super fun. Yeah, cool. Let's see. I'm just checking out the comments in the chat. You didn't think that the vocals had some resonances. I do think the vocals had some resonance stuff, but there wasn't anything that was eating my ears. And it's also par for the course. Like in a distorted vocal, that's going to happen a bit. But yeah, it might be something to check out too. Thanks, Benjamin, for that. Cool. Thank you so much for submitting this. All right. I'm going to take one more from the chat. Let me go up in the chat a little bit. Let's see here. Carl Gibson. Let's hear your new version. Carl Gibson. Dark Roses. Here we go. I'm excited to hear this.
Just can't seem to find the words to say. can feel you, but there's nothing in the way.
Call a blind dinosaur. Do you think he saw us? I had to do it. Sorry. Awesome. I love this freaking track. Thank you, Carl, for doing another pass on it. That's awesome. I'm hearing, I'm remembering this one now because I think that we've done this tune on maybe two mix tanks. And I hear a lot of the changes happening on this version. I think it's coming along really freaking well. So you said, I think I'm just about done with this mix. I've done my best to employ some of the advice given on previous mix tank sessions. I didn't seem to be hearing things that seemed obvious, so I changed my room around to get a clearer picture. As always, thanks for listening. Feedback much appreciated. Awesome. Cool. I hope that the room changes helped out. Let me know in the chat if you felt like it worked a little bit. Cool. So what I'm kind of hearing on this, so I don't really remember my comments from before. But just kind of reacting to what I'm hearing right now, I'm feeling like in verse one, for example, the guitar is more present than the vocal. And as the song progressed, I started feeling that way kind of about everything. But I think I remember that the vocal was bitey before, a little harsh in like the 3K range, and it doesn't feel bitey to me now. So that's awesome. If my memory is serving me right, then I think like it's sitting in a really good spot. We'll talk about volume of it and presence of it in a second, but the guitar feels more present than the vocal. So it feels louder, it feels more clear in the upper mids, and it's more present, right? So One thing I would try with that would be just bringing the guitar back and maybe moving it to the right or left just a little bit. I mean, even like, throwing it off to the one side or the other, by 12. Not so that it feels like an obvious pan move, but it's just making a little bit of room. So if it's like sitting here with the vocal, it just kind of goes like that and lets the vocal kind of sneak by, right? And become a little more in focus too. So yeah, I'd say just get it out of the way a little bit of the vocal, maybe bring it down a bit. And then overall, I felt like the drums are too loud. And at some points, I feel like the guitars are a little bit too loud, just relative to the vocal. So again, like, what a freaking vocal performance. This needs to be like the highlight of the mix. So I think like the drums could just kind of everybody just again come back and let the singer step forward and be the main focal point. Because that's certainly like there's amazing playing going on in the whole thing, but that vocal is the key there. So inside of the drums with the snare drum, I feel like there's a lot of low mid build up, like 300-ish kind of thing going on. There's some sort of woolly boxiness, I guess I would say, to it. So maybe just look at it with an EQ a little bit and see if you can have it, do less of a mask thing and more of a, again, focused picture. It feels a little diffuse with all that extra mid-range, low mid-range. The kick feels like it's got a little bit of a cloud around like 160 or so too. So just see if there's anything to clean up in there. You don't want to steal tone away. That's where a lot of tone happens, but just taking anything that feels like build up kind of deal. I hadn't heard the octave line of the piano entering into the choruses. That octave line is awesome. It might be a hair too loud, but it's also really cool and you made a moment out of it, so could be great. At the very end, when you do the push for they do the like the rest and then the big hits on there, I feel you automating the band up and it, kind of making a big thing out of those hits. The vocals got to go with it in order to continue selling the song. So it does feel cool that everybody kind of comes in and like really bashes those hits. It feels live that way, like there's dynamic in it that's happening, and that's awesome. The vocal should go up with it. It felt like it was static from the section before into that. And if everybody's going to get louder and more excited, the vocal should as well. That was pretty much all I had for it, but I think like it's come a really, really long way. And awesome job, Carl. That's great. So let's see. James Vlogs asks if we accept mixes from Adobe Audition. We'll take mixes from two Walkmen that you've put together and balanced together. Those are awesome. Anything. Doesn't matter where you made it, doesn't matter what you use. Great things have been done with little to nothing. So absolutely we'll take that, James. And let's see what else we got here. You got it, Armis. We'll hit it. There's really good comments in the chat as well. And let's go on to another tune. So yeah, Carl, thank you for being here and thank you for trying out some of those comments and stuff, and I hope it's useful. Yeah, always remember like everything is take any comment to taste, and everything is personal preference, and all of this is so subjective that it's really hard to do these as well. Like I'm sure you can imagine, like to give comments on the stuff, and it's always up to you, the mixer. Cool. I hope it's useful. Let's go on here. So let's hit Aramis's track. So partir. Let's see. Okay, cool. I got it. Armis Music. So this is an advanced mix. He says, "Hi guys, this is a song I made with the Brazilian singer, so it's in three languages. Awesome. I think we're getting close with the mix. I'm still not sure about the vocal compression, reverb, and EQ. If the mix is too boomy in general, be nice to get your opinion. Here we go. All right. Thanks for submitting and for being here. Here we go."
Não conseguimos, chegamos.
Et je fixe la ficelle attachée à moi. Perdu des amis, des amours, des emplois et mes âmes en combat. J'ai pas toujours été parfait, je le reconnais, aucun regret. J'avance en regardant derrière pour ne pas faire les mêmes erreurs qu'hier. Et j'aime bien sans faire de quoi. J'ai pas de misère à ma tête. J'introduis plus de douceur. Tel un vent chaud.
Awesome song. This is super cool. Great job, RMS. Well produced too. Yeah, there's a lot of great stuff going on in there. That's super cool and definitely an advanced mix. Okay, so let me just answer two questions from the chat. So first up, James Vlogs, do I need to be a member to upload my track? So Mixtank is for pro members. We do the live streams for everybody, but puremix.net, if you're a pro member, go to Mixtank up at the top, and then you can submit a mix for it. Let's see what else we got here. There was another thing I was going to comment on. Oh, yeah, so Carl Gibson said, thanks for the feedback, definitely useful comments. Would you recommend trying a mix on headphones, or can this throw up more issues? It can throw up more issues, but it'll help you hear some of the low-end stuff better. The things that I have problems balancing out in headphones, it's usually stuff like drum vocal balance, or like where that lead vocal sits. And that's because of the phantom center that we get from stereo speakers. If your speakers are set up properly, you should hear a really defined center image. And that, for anything that's in the middle, like panned up the middle, that's because the when you have something panned in the center, it appears that way because the speakers are playing the same signal on both the left and the right side. And if the speakers are arriving at your ear at the same time, you'll hear a great center image. If you have one speaker that's back here and the sound from this one gets to your ear earlier than this one, you're going to have a bit of like a diffused, smeared center image. So you're going for a really defined center image on that stuff. And then that makes it very easy to do things like volume placement between vocal and snare drum and all of those kinds of things. So check your monitoring, same distance, speaker to speaker, like to your ears. The equilateral triangle thing, some people like to have the apex of the triangle behind their head, some people like to have it at their ears. That's preference, but you want the speakers to be the exact same distance from your left ear and your right ear on both sides. So check that out. Speaker placement is usually a lot of that stuff. And if it's off, that's where people feel like they need to overwiden things and they can't hear that it's kind of getting phasey and all that too. So enough about that, back to here. So hope that helps, Carl. Okay, let's do on our track from Aramis. So in the vocal, I felt like I was hearing on the female vocal that came in first, there was some low mid stuff that was happening in there, like some resonance, a little bit of like honkiness, and that was around like the 300-ish range to me. The next thing that really stuck out to me, which this comes up a lot, is the mix feels ultra wide. So like there's stereo widening going on with it. And all of that stuff, I've talked about this probably on every mix tank, but it makes everything feel out of focus to me and diffuse. So it's the same, like if you're, you know, looking at my face back here, I'm out of focus compared to my hand. And that's how like stereo widening makes a mix feel to me. So I don't think it needs to be as wide as it is right now. And I think if you tuck some of that back, the instruments are going to have more definition. They're going to be clearer. And again, just more in focus. So especially the first spot to like, there was a diffused guitar that was happening on the right side that I almost felt like it was, it felt like I was listening to Atmos because it's wrapping around my head and I'm hearing it like so wide. And in theory, that sounds awesome, right? Like, how can we make a mix sound like it's just enveloping the room from two speakers? And the answer is stereo widening tricks. But a lot of times to me, it feels artificial. And I think to the listener, it just feels like things aren't clear and they're kind of washy. And it's just hard for the ear to pin a location to something in that. So in general, with that kind of stuff, I think like just let stereo be stereo and make the best of your canvas that you have to play in with the speakers. If things never feel wide to you, it could be that your speakers are just too close to each other compared to like how they're coming to your ears. So play around again with speaker placement. It's everything. There's nothing more important, no plugin, no piece of gear, no outboard, no microphone, that's more important than your listening environment and your speakers and making sure that that is killer. Once that's there, the rest of it is kind of easy, and you can actually hear the differences between all the plugins and all that stuff too. So monitors. I was thinking like for excitement levels, when you get to the French rap part, a mono delay might be kind of cool, like with a low pass filter on it and just tucked up underneath like a 16th note. Just something that like, it's not super present, but it's just kind of in there and it would add to some of the spaciness feel that's going on with the track and the mix that was on there. Overall, things felt a little bit boomy. I think Tom pointed that out as well. And he mentioned that like a high pass filter on the entire mix can kind of clean that up. I would say go into the individual elements of the mix first and see if you can clean it. Like if the kick is really boomy and extending all that low end, maybe just clean up the kick and that might allow other elements to speak a little bit better. But yeah, check out the bass relationship between the bass and the kick. If you can't hear it in your room, headphones are great for this. Just try to clean up some of the low end, just tighten it up a little bit. That's also, again, going to help tighten up your groove. Anytime that we have rumbling subs and all that stuff, there's a lot of just lurking energy down there that is just swamping up the groove. And you have great musicians on this. The playing is great. So need to preserve that and just make sure the low end is under control. Overall, yeah, just felt like some vocal clarity was needed. So, you know, play around with some EQ things, see what you can do to kind of make it more present. Play around with the mid-range of the vocal, you know, in the 1K all the way up to, you know, 4 or 5K, whatever. And just see if there's some frequencies that, you know, if you're going with an EQ and just kind of moving around, see if there's some areas that make the vocal speak. And when I say make it speak, it'll feel like it just kind of comes alive and stops having like a plastic sheen to it or like a muffled kind of sheen. It'll just feel more realistic. And hope that makes sense. But yeah, this is a great track and I think you're on the way to something super awesome. All right. Hope that that's useful. Let me check out the chat, see how everybody's doing, and we'll hit another mix. I think we're going to go for about 30 more minutes here. So you guys can let me know in the chat too if you feel like I should be using the draw track button more. Feel free to yell at me. All right. Let's see what we got going on. So, if I haven't hit your mix yet and you put it in the chat, if you wouldn't mind putting it in there one more time for me, that would help so I don't have to scroll back through all of it and you guys are watching me scroll on my screen. So I'm going to do draw a track, and sorry to make you guys do it again, but if you could put your track in there again, that would be super helpful. Oh, wait. Jen Soldrich, I don't think I've hit yours yet. Let's check that out. Oh, and Jacob Corbin, The Perfect Band. We'll definitely do those two. Okay, so Perfect Band will be next. Let's check out Jen Soldrich here. Here we go.
Open up your eyes just for a while and see the night. The light is just a vision that you know. Light is filled with fire and the screams of those you love. Night is what the waking ones behold. Behold. leaves you alone. But every now and then the night will bind itself to bone. You'll see the world with different eyes, find darkness in the light, and listen for the song you've always known.
Awesome, Jen. Very cool song. It says this is a song of yours. Great job on it. Really cool writing and everything. Yeah, that's great. It's really fun. There's a lot of opportunity to make some moments in this track, given the arrangement that you've done and sort of the picture that the music is creating for me. There's a lot of things I think that could be done to really sell that and amplify it a bit. So the, my spell corrected something weird there. Let's talk about first the kick tom relationship in the building, in the beginning of it. The kick drum is very light and the piano is pretty loud, and then some toms enter and the relationship between the kick and the toms feels unbalanced to me. So I think that like the pulse of the kick drum really helps throughout the beginning and in that section to kind of keep the things moving and keep the song going. And I also think that it works well with the tom groove. So I would kind of bring that kick up and make it more of a section together. I'm curious while I'm kind of yapping at you here. It feels like a rough mix to me in the sense that like you might have finished composing it and this is sort of where it's at. So I'm wondering if you do, when you started this, if you did like a faders down thing where you started from scratch, like brought all the things down to zero and then started putting them in, or if you kind of continued on from wherever it was in the production stage. So let me know in the chat about that and then we'll talk about that in a minute. The guitar at 125 had an awesome tone to me and I wanted that part to be louder. So kind of bringing that up and making more of an event out of it. Overall in the song, the piano seems to be the anchor to me. I would try possibly bringing that, we'll talk about that in a second. The piano seems to be the anchor. We'll talk about bringing things in relation around it in a second after I hear from you in the chat. So it says, the vocal is very, very dry. And this is kind of where I think that you could have a lot of fun to paint a picture of the song that supports the music and everything. I think like doing some really interesting delay effects, like they can be mono delay effects, just some things to kind of like add a little bit of space behind the vocal, that not over the top overproduced stuff, but just little things happening in the background. Like even just a filtered, you know, 16th delay, slap vocal, just barely audible underneath the vocal can help it pop forward and give some depth to it. So I'm just making it seem like it extends back into the speakers. So little moments like reverb throws or, delay throws or distorted reverb throws, like just little things that you could do to make events happen here and there around the important lyrics and some of the important things in the song, especially going from like section to section and things like that. The vocal feels like it could use some compression overall. There's parts that get really quiet. Like there's a lyric, where you say bind itself to bone that was sung louder, but very quiet. So I would think compression on that, but it sounded very clean. So it might've been a vocal ride, but there's other, you know, as the vocal performance is going, there's words that pop out of the speakers and then ones that recess back. And I think it could benefit from some compression. Another useful thing is just parallel compression with that. So if you, had like a copy of the vocal either on like a, you know, an aux return, or if you just duplicated the track and compress the snot out of it, not to like the point of distortion if you don't want distortion, but just do a super compressed package of it and blend it up into that original vocal. That's going to have the effect of reducing the dynamic range without feeling like it's being overcompressed. So that is a good case for parallel compression on the vocal there. But you may also just need some more compression on the actual source track too. At 250, the guitar solo, I felt like that needed to be an event. There needed to be some space around it. and maybe like some just kind of texture around it to bring out the moment. It felt like it was recessed behind that piano, which is kind of the anchor of the tune. But it was the thing that we wanted to be listening to at the moment. At least the musical arrangement was telling me this is the featured part right now. So it needs to be more present and out in front of that piano a little bit. The bass felt like it could use some definition too. Again, like some distortion can help a bass guitar that's very subby and dull. Just again, have some texture and come out of the speakers a little bit, help it translate better. Watch the mid-range on it, just making sure that it speaks well. Again, 800, 1.6, great places to start. Watch the timing of it with the kick drum. From time to time, I heard like it was a little bit off. You could do very broad stroke editing to just kind of make sure that those guys are playing well together. And it felt like on the piano run, on the bum, 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 on that melody, it might be cool to do a really short delay on the piano there. And again, just like adding some depth, there's some texture to it to just make some moments. Same with the vocals, just like, you know, dressing them up a little bit. And then watch out for mouth pops and clicks. A lot of that stuff can be edited out, but if you're hearing it all over the track, Isotope mouth declick is incredible for it. Default settings, just process, and it's usually great. So going back to the faders down thing, so you say you did not start with the faders down. So that's okay. I think a useful exercise in this would be if the piano is the sort of the anchor musically, if you bring that guy up to a good level, so it's like gain staging looks good and all that stuff, bring it up to a certain point, or even just start with where it's at right now and try do a save as so you don't lose everything that you've done, but bring all the faders down around it and then think about whatever fader you're about to pull up. Imagine it. Sorry, I was still talking. I don't know when I hit that. What happened? I'm still here. Not sure what that happened. Imagine the stream shot stopping. Says round by. There we go. I'm coming back, guys. Here we go. All right, I'll just assume I'm back. So I don't remember the last thing I said. So I'm going to start back with the faders down thing. So the piano feels like the anchor to me. That was a fantastic moment. So let's say that the piano is the anchor. If you bring all the faders down around it, do a save as so you don't lose what you got. But imagine what you want to, like where you want the element to be around that piano, and bring the fader up into position so it feels that way. I think of balance in terms of depth. So like bringing a fader up will bring something closer to me, and EQ the same way. But make sure the speakers are in a good position that we talked about earlier. And then I would just try rebalancing this mix with that kind of stuff in mind about where should things be in relation to each other and to you, the listener, on it. And then from there, like that's where volume automation really starts to make a lot of sense and be more important. Like that guitar solo is the moment. Let's boost the guitar solo in that moment. And then you can ride things and add a little bit of performance and personality to it to put some of yourself into it. But yeah, I think it's a great tune, and you've got a lot to work with there. There's so many opportunities to kind of like build space around it and everything. Karen, I hit a button on my stream deck that I shouldn't have hit. So cool. Primetime's got a mix for us. That's awesome. So Jen, let me know in the chat if that makes sense, and I could elaborate on something if it doesn't. I'm going to go on to the next mix and come back to this, but I would love to hear another mix of this too. So please consider doing another pass for our next mix tank, and we'll hit it. Okay, I'm going to put my comment there, even though I know you're here. All right, and let's do Primetime. Awesome. Glad it's helpful, Jen. Yeah, let me know if I should elaborate. Okay, here we go. Primetime Robots, my man. Okay. This is F-Mix V003, Mr. Plus Emotional Mix. Awesome. All right. So he says, hello, music lovers. It's my second mix here. I made up my own mind not to become a rabbit hole designer. Nice. With this mix, I added things creatively here and there. Let's see. I tried to keep the tensions tight. Please let me know where I completely missed the mark. Thanks for your time and ears. All right. Here we go.
Said you love somebody else. I can't do a thing about it. I should only blame myself. Yeah. You set my heart upon the shelf as if you would come back. You left me for dead, yeah. Just wanted you to know.
I'm going to pause here just to talk about one thing in particular that kind of relates to some of the other things I've said on the other mixes. Listen to, when I hit play again, listen to the relationship of the snare to the vocal, both in volume and tonal balance. So I'm going to hit play a little bit and then I'll talk a little bit more.
You said you love somebody else. I can't do a thing.
Okay, so just to talk about that again for a second, this mix is feeling like it's got a good groove to it. It's exciting, and I know this song very, very well, so awesome job. Okay, so that snare vocal thing, the snare has a lot of attack to it and a lot of smack to it. So the way that I'm like picturing in my head how to explain this would be like, imagine that you and I are having a conversation. I don't think I have a piece of paper to do this with, but you and I are having a conversation, and like, your worst friend who like thinks he's super funny, but he's just obnoxious. He keeps taking a piece of paper and he puts it in between us and smacks it like for the snare hit. And then he goes away. And then I'm trying to talk to you and explain something to you. And he comes back out and he's like, smack. And then he just keeps on doing that over and over again. So that's what the snare is doing to me in the mix right now. And it did this in the chorus, in the first verse, and in this verse as well. I'm trying to listen to the singer. And then a very bright snare comes out and cracks right in front of me. And it kind of distracts me from like, I'm trying to connect with the vocal. So the vocal is darker than the snare. The snare has a really awesome smack and transient to it, but it's, you could maybe get away with that if you bring the volume of the snare down and still keep that same kind of transient, you know, response to it. Because not to go down another rabbit hole, but doing EQ moves changes transient response, right? Like if I bring a lot of smack into something, it's going to have a much harsher transient than if it's dull, right? So always be thinking about that too. And sometimes you can get yourself in trouble with compression because you could EQ the snare and then be like, oh, it's got way too much of a transient. I'll throw a compressor on there with a fast attack and clip that off. It's like, well, you could probably also just EQ some of that mid-range out and not compress. So that's something to like look at on this one. Just where that snare is at, again, like in relation to the vocal and then its tonal balance as well as its level and dynamics to it. So that's, I wanted to just kind of make that point there, and let's keep going. Here we go.
I got a heart shape all coming out of my chest. Should give you something more, but there ain't nothing left. I
loved you more than life, but you left me for dead. Just wanted you to know that this is all.
You could probably deal with some of this noise at the end here. So watch out for that stuff. Just edit it out if you can, and let those, like, you know, delay and reverb tails just kind of bloom out and be beautiful and all that stuff. Yeah, the noise is stealing from the emotion of that at the very ending. So I think a lot of my comments are covered by Sonic and Tom on this. That snare thing's really important to me. Just make sure that that's not stealing from the vocal like that. The pumping effect that Sonic mentioned, I kind of feel that too. Like, it sometimes it feels like it's fighting against the music, but this mix feels very exciting to me. And again, like, I know this song really well. This is from a video from Fab DuPont. Yeah, this is the How I Feel Inside. So Fab mixed this song, and some other people have. It was produced by Angel Lopez, who did Jack Harlow's First Class and that whole record that's like killing it right now. They brought out Fergie on the VMAs last night for it. Fergie. So that was cool because the sample in the song is from Fergie. But anyway, yeah, great, like, really well-produced track, and it was already, like, a really well-produced thing, and I feel like you did some stuff on here that kind of, like, really accentuated some of the things going on in the track, but it had a good groove, and the choruses feel like they explode, and I love all that stuff that you did. So other than that, like, just watch out for artificial widening stuff. I heard a little bit of that stuff going on that just make things feel diffuse and all that jazz. Yeah, I think that he had some good points on the pumping, and I loved all the stuff that you added on there, and I agreed with that we were losing the vocal in the chorus, but again, I think that some of that is coming from the snare. The chop stuff that you added was awesome. I love that you took some, like, chances on this and added some things and did all that, and that's always, like, a thing that can make you stand out to a client too. You don't want to overdo it so they feel like you've decided to make yourself a part of the band, but if you bring something new to the table, Joe Ciccarelli talked about this recently on one of our live streams too. If you bring something to the table that maybe they didn't think about, they feel like you're a part of the team and not just, like, turning what they gave you back over to them with a little bit more sheen or something like that. So always great to do that stuff, and you know, with taste and everything, of course, but trying to add something there. And then if you got to mute it, you got to mute it. That happens to me frequently. I'll do a mix and send something, and I will have, like, worked on a particular element of the mix, like a, you know, delay trick or something like that. And sometimes they're like, oh my God, I love that. And then other times they're like, oh, I feel like it's a little distracting. Let's just mute it, you know? Or we'll try to make it work for a little while, and then we'll just be like, oh, we're having to fight too much with this. Let's just get rid of it. All of that's okay. You don't need to be attached to it, but it's good to add something to the table. So I love that you did that, and great job on this prime time. It does feel like there's an energy to it. That's really awesome. Maybe a little bit more punch in the kick. I wanted to hear some more of that stuff that really lends itself to the genre, and, like, it's punchy, it's, you know, it's very, like, glamorous sounding and all of that stuff. So hope that helps. Thank you for being here as always. Great to see you did this mix. So let's see what else we got. We got to do is it the greatest band? It is the perfect band. Awesome. I saw you in the chat and took me a minute to get here, but here we go. All right, Gary Prague. So this mix, I think we did it last week and maybe the one before. He says, last minute changes to remove the boxiness and add more punch to the drums and bass. And then you left a comment on your thing. It says, personally, I think that I pushed too much high mid about 4K. I find it too hard to balance between openness and excitement and fatiguing. My mix sounds too hard, I think, compared to many other mixes, which sound softer. All right, let's check it out, Gary. Here we go.
And no, no, I'm not kidding. Jay and Spike could groove the beat steady and on point. No, no one would stay in their seat when these two rock the joint. When these two rock the joint. They were the perfect band. Well, touching people of all ages, touching people of all ages. They were the perfect band. Well, fitted part that made it all. Their music, like the promised land, could soothe the crying soul. Could soothe the crying soul. That made it whole, their music, like the promised land, could soothe the crying soul, could soothe the crying soul.
We could have been the perfect band, had they ever met.
Man, I had to listen to that last guitar part again because that tone is beautiful. I'm like super jealous of that. You got to let me know what that is. That sounds gorgeous right there, that last guitar part. That's amazing. Awesome job. Cool. Okay, Gray Prague. This is from Jacob. So Jacob, so glad you're in here. Thank you for waiting for us to get to it. Awesome. Okay, so you put in your comment, I think it pushes too much in the high mid at about 4K. And that you did some last minute changes to remove boxiness and add more punch to the drums and bass. So, I would agree with you that it sounds harsh right now. I think it is, and that it's a little fatiguing. I would say that is primarily happening to me in the guitars and the vocals, and the drums. Maybe I hear a little bit of harshness in the cymbals, but, in relation to them, they don't feel like they're the same shape, if that makes sense. It's almost like the drums have a mix and then the rest of the instruments have a mix. And if like I were to think about how I would recreate that, I would have like a drum sub and then I would have the everything else sub. And it's like you put an EQ on the everything else sub that gave it a different tonal shape than the drums, if that makes sense. I will say, like, I think that the kick and the bass sound better than I remember the last one sounding. But we have the auditory memory of a fish, so I could be wrong. But it feels to me like you've done some improvements on this from the last time that I heard it. So I have a recommendation on the guitars and vocals thing, and the harshness thing overall. Gray, I don't know, or Jacob, I don't know if you are in. Oh, awesome, cool. Freeman JJ Jr. PRS Custom 24. That's not a bad signal chain. Awesome. Okay, so I'm wondering what DAW you're in, and I want to talk about something called trim mode. So let me know in the chat which DAW you're in, but and it doesn't matter because they all the DAWs have this, but there is a automation mode called trim. And what trim is awesome for is, let's say that you did a bunch of rides on a particular instrument, and then you like all the rides that you did, but you want, say, the vocal to be a dB louder in the entire mix. Well, if you throw it in the trim mode, your fader will go to zero, like unity, and all of your automation is preserved. But when you turn that fader up or down, it's like just turning up the output volume of a, like the last insert on the track. You're just making the track louder versus erasing your automation move. So, what I would do for this, assuming that you have some automation on this other stuff, I would pop everything first, do a save as, because I don't want you to like lose anything. So do a save as. And then this is just like a practice exercise, okay? So like you might not use this for the end, but it's a good exercise. Throw everything in the trim mode and then leave the drums and bass kind of where they are. I think that there's some more that could be done with the bass to just bring it out a bit, but bring down all those guitars and the vocals, and then just start bringing stuff up one by one. So again, like kind of decide who's important, and then think about where it should be in relation to the rhythm section. So I would try starting with that lead vocal and just bring it up until it feels good and balanced versus the drums, and then start bringing the guitars up against them. Right now, what I feel like is happening, and the reason I'm suggesting this, is because the guitars and the vocals feel like they're sitting way on top of the mix and they have that different EQ shape. Before you try messing with EQ on any of that stuff or like going after that harsh feeling about it, I would mess with the volume of it first. So, try this trick. Just bring those things down into a different balance. And then, okay, yeah, so you're using Logic, you just put in the chat, and you definitely have trim mode in Logic. So bring those faders down, bring them back up into the balance. Once you're done with that, once you've kind of like brought all those faders up, just stop, go get some coffee, and then come back, listen to the original mix first, and then listen to the newly balanced one and see what you glean from that. So what like your feelings are about it, if you're like, no, this one's way worse, or like the original, oh wow, those things were too loud. Just see what you learn from hearing that contrast of it. I think it's going to be a worthwhile exercise, and it'll help you on the next mix just as much as it would on this one. But then, like after you kind of balance those things, then see if you still feel like they're too harsh. Because a lot of times, something that has a lot of mid-range presence like this, it could be that it's a good balance and a good shape. It's just too loud, and needs to kind of come back. Once you kind of get it balanced, it might inform you too. Like you might feel like the drums are dull at that point, and maybe you want to look at some stuff there. Or you might still feel that the other elements are too harsh, or that there's too much 4K, and then you dial back some of the EQ that you did. But yeah, I hope that that's useful. The only other thing I had was in the bridge, the lead vocal feels a little bit inaudible to me. It's way quieter, and I kind of talked about that with that first song that I was recommending at the beginning of the stream, Muddy Waters from LP. She does a great job of like stripping everything away in the bridge, but it doesn't feel like it loses momentum or energy. And this is something that I struggle with personally a lot, is just making sure like I don't come down too far in the bridge. So whereas the rest of the vocals in the song were like really, really loud and on top of the mix to me, the bridge vocal was inaudible. So I would want to hear that bridge vocal come a little bit closer to wherever the lead vocal is going to sit. Hope that that helps. The guitar fade into the bridge, you did like a reverb throw or something in there. That was super awesome and killer, and I wanted to bring it, like just make a note of that. Great job on that. So yeah, I think this is great and it's coming along. Yeah, if you get to do another pass, I'd love to check it out again. So let me know, and I'll put the thing in the comments so I get notified if you put another comment in here. And yeah, thanks so much for being here as always and submitting a mix. Okay, let's see. I'm going to do a draw track, and let's do this. I'm going to do another track from the draw track. And if anybody's in the chat that I haven't hit your mix yet, yell at me now in the chat. Put the song title and your Puremix username if you can. My pleasure, Jacob. Yeah, thank you again for being here. Yeah, and so remind me in the chat if you've got a song and you're here. We'll listen to it before we go. And right now I'm going to draw a track in this. Unless somebody throws something in the chat, this might be our last one for the day. But before I go, I want an announcement thing. So this, we're going to start moving to bi-weekly after today. So we won't be here next Monday. It's Labor Day, and I'm going to be out of town. So no Mix Tank next Monday, but we'll be back the week after that. And then we'll probably be doing bi-weekly from there forward. But we're going to have a different stream that will eventually fill in those off weeks. If you've seen my plugin review show on YouTube, I'm going to be doing live plugin reviews with you guys, and you guys can yell at me in the chat and be like, oh, I want to hear what happens if you do this, and we'll play with it and figure some stuff out. So we'll find some new plugins and obscure stuff or stuff that I love, and we'll talk about them on live. So it'll be like a live plugin review show. So that's coming soon. But yeah, no Mix Tank next week. But I'd love to hear new versions of all the stuff that we did today if you guys put them up, and so on. So yeah, yell at me in the chat or in the chat. We got Higher Ground Remix. So this is from Jeff Mayo. So let's do this Higher Ground Remix. Okay, user is OWO, and it's Jeff Mayo in the chat. And Christopher Stricker, you've got it. So let's check out these two. Here we go. Oh, Primetime, sorry. You put, hey, Mark, to refresh my ears, I sometimes rub behind my ears briefly and swallow one or two times to help me keep my ears open. Then my ears are free on a certain focus. Yeah. I do that as well. Yeah, it's kind of interesting. Like sometimes I'll like pinch the lobes of my ears too, to get like blood kind of flowing in that area. And then, yeah, behind there's like a, I think there's a lymph node back there. I'm not a doctor, but I might be wrong, but, sometimes I'll kind of like rub back there. All of your sinuses and everything and all of that's connected. And, I know like my sinuses are very sensitive to weather change and all of those things, and it'll affect my hearing. And that's where like reference mixes become so important. A lot of the stuff that I'm talking about in the beginning of these live streams are reference mixes that I use to kind of figure out like, all right, ears, what are you doing today? Did the speaker sound different today? Or, you know, what's going on with my ears or the environment or whatever, humidity plays a factor, all those things. But yeah, I do stuff like that. And then I regularly go to an ear doctor to make sure everything's clear in there. Any other tips? I'd say like breaks are the other important thing. Like that's why I recommended going to get a coffee, to just like let your ears reset, and also let your auditory memory reset after doing something like that, so you kind of forget what it sounds like. Yeah, hope that helps. Okay, here we go. So this is Higher Ground. We'll be right back.
never knew that I'm gonna keep on trying till I reach the higher. I'm gonna keep on trying till I reach the higher.
There we go. There's my microphone. Awesome stuff. Man, very cool, OO. Great job on this. I'm interested to know if you are involved in producing this and tracking and all of that stuff, too. So if you could let me know in the chat, that'd be awesome. And I'll just start kind of talking about stuff I hear. So the first thing that jumped out to me was the bottom end of the track overall. I feel like we're missing a lot of low-end information. And with something that moves this fast or has this kind of groove, again, you want to watch out with how much sub is in there because it can slow the track down and feel sluggish and big and, you know, like it's just kind of going on forever. I think that this could benefit from some more bottom stuff. There's things I would comment about on the mix range or on the mid range, but if is out of context with not having enough low end. So I think like the kick drum needs to be like have a little bit more bottom, and the bass guitar needs a little bit more bottom, and all of that kind of stuff. Otherwise we're left with just the mids, and then you could say it sounds boxy, but it sounds boxy because there's not a lot of bottom. So instead of like that comment of it sounds boxy might make you think like, oh, I need to cut some 500, but then you're just kind of cutting away what's left of the signal. So I would just play around and see if you can get some low end back in the track and make it a little bit thicker, a little bit meaner, like a little bit, you know, put some weight on it. Let's see here. So the rhythm guitar effects, I think it was at the beginning of it when it's kind of doing like the bend and it. There's like a reverb tail that's going on for a long time and some delay stuff. The short delay things I think that you have in there are pretty cool, and they could probably stay because they're emphasizing the groove of it. But the reverb feels like it kind of trails on, and it's taking away the articulation of the very rhythmically inclined guitar player because it's just kind of becoming washy. So he's playing very like staccato-y short rhythm blasts, and then this reverb is kind of like putting a cloud over top of that and stealing away from the groove that he's setting for the rest of the track. The bass guitar, I felt like it could have a little bit more texture or grit, and it also just kind of needs some more weight. Same thing I put in the kick. At 125, this is why I was wondering if you... Okay, yeah, so Jeff, you did all the tracking producing. That's awesome. At 125, I want to take a listen to this again. And I did this while we were listening to... You probably saw, or sorry, it's probably like more like 117 here. Let's just listen to this section one more time. Freaking killer vocal effects. That's awesome.
That's so good, he let me try it again. But this time around, I lived the whole world of sin. I'm so glad I know more than I knew then. I'm gonna keep on trying till I reach the higher.
So I love the take on this section of the song and like how you've decided to treat this first chorus here. The bass guitar is doing like almost like a reggae upbeat kind of like, and that works well with the vocal. But then we have the guitar that's still doing like a scat kind of thing. And it feels like that groove is doing like a push pull thing against the vocal to me. So there's too many like kind of conflicting rhythms that are keeping me from focusing on the vocal. Whereas I think if you committed to that upbeat thing that the bass is doing and did almost like a reggae feel for that one section, and then it goes into the super cool vocal effect that you do at the end here. Back to full tempo, like driving straight ahead, you know, higher ground that we love or whatever. I think it would be cool to mess with like a reggae feel on that chorus thing. Just a thought. But yeah, I think like the, I don't know if those effects are on the guitar here too. Yeah, so it's just two guitars kind of playing somewhat different rhythms. There's just a lot of rhythm stuff that's happening that's not all in sync with each other. They're not necessarily out of time. They're just not arranged together, and it's pulling me away from the vocal. So just a thought I had on that. And then at 220, I felt like the vocal was getting harsh. Let me just check that out. Yeah, so it's getting harsh, but it could again be the thing, like if you were able to get some more low end out of the other instruments, especially the foundation rhythm instruments, it might not feel like that vocal's as harsh. It's just that it's so, it's on top and there's not a lot of information below, which makes it feel unbalanced to me. But again, like before you go cutting, see if there's something else that you can do to kind of like make things feel more tonally balanced. And I'm thinking, like, when I say something like that, I'm thinking of, like, you know, if you look at, like, a the basic EQ in Logic or, like, FabFilter Pro Q, you have, like, 20 hertz to 20 kilohertz on a parametric thing. It's just kind of feeling like there's a tilt EQ on it that feels like the, I guess for you guys it would look like this. Like, the bass is just down here and the top end's up here. So just trying to get things a little bit more balanced overall in the tonal balance of it. Yeah. I hope that some of that stuff helps. There's a lot of cool things that are going on in here. Tomfoolery says trippy. Nice. He always has great comments, so I definitely check out what he's got in here too. Same with Sonic Science. Great. Very cool. I hope that helps, Jeff. Great job on tracking and producing this, because that's not an easy track to produce either. So that's awesome. Very cool. I like your tempo changes too. That's pretty neat. Okay. Okay, so I think Carl asked above. Let me look at the chat real quick. Somebody was asking about headphones. Carl Gibson, can you recommend any headphones that would give me a clear idea of what's going on when mixing, closed or open backed? And then somebody said, open back Sennheiser 650s. With SonarWorks Rev 4. So don't worry about SonarWorks for a second. The Sennheisers, I have the 600s. I love those things. And I heard like the 650s are cool too. I forget what the difference is tonally between the two. Open backs have a more natural feeling bottom to them, in my opinion. But you trade off like some noise in the room. Like you're going to hear ambient noise around you and stuff while you're listening, and they have more bleed. So they're not a great tracking headphone. But yeah, I use 600s and I love to do mid-range work on them for sure. For low-end stuff, you guys are going to all unsubscribe when I say this, but I stay on my speakers for probably like 95% of the mix, and then I'll switch over to headphones and I'll go between the HD600s. I have a Little Labs headphone amp as well. It's called like a monitor or something like that. Yeah, Little Labs monitor. That's what my 600s are plugged into. And then I'll go between those for detailed work and like hypercritical work. And then I'll throw in my AirPods, my AirPod Pros, and I'll listen for anything that might be bugging me on those. And then if I make changes, I'll double check that those changes are okay on my speakers and HD600s. And then I'll do another pass on, I have AirPod Maxes. And I got the AirPod Maxes primarily just for figuring out Apple Spatial, and I wanted to hear what Apple was listening to, that they were doing their thing. But I also found out that I could get a lot of information about the low end of the track from those two. I don't feel like I actually really like those headphones, and they don't sound like Beats where it's just like all bottom end or anything, but I like the AirPod Maxes. So I'll do a little bit of work on those as well. Again, just checking low end stuff, and then how's the mid range doing, all of that. And between like those AirPod Pros and the AirPod Max, I feel like I'm kind of dealing with like the consumer version of the mix. And then I've got more detailed mid range from those HD600s. But most of the time I'm just on my speakers. It's just like a final check through on headphones to make sure things are feeling right. But I have also spent a lot of time dialing in the low end of this room. I have some amazing speakers for low end translation and all that. So I'm confident with the picture I'm getting from my monitors in the first place. And I, you know, spent a lot of time on the monitors and learned them that way. But yeah, so HD600s are great. And then, you know, some consumer headphone I don't think is a bad idea, just to understand what people are going to be hearing. And if you already have something like AirPods or any other wireless earbud or something like that, that you know well because you listen to music on it, when you put those on while you're doing a mix, you're going to have an oral memory of, well, that's not how music normally sounds to me in my headphones or whatever. So that can be a really good reference point for you if it's something that you use a lot. And to get sound to my AirPods and to my AirPod Max, I use a program called Loopback. And I can add those as a source and then route, in my case, I use Pro Tools, but I can route the output of Pro Tools through Loopback and then out to my AirPods. So I can be wearing my AirPods and doing a mix at the same time if I want to be. So now that you've also unsubscribed, I hope that helps out. Cool. Yeah, that's great. Let me just see if there was another one that was posted in here. Real quick. Christopher Stricker said "You've Got It" in caps case, so I'm gonna assume that's a song title. Let's see. You've Got It. You've Got It. Here it is. C. Stricker. All right. So I think this is gonna be our last one for the day. So thank you guys all for tuning in. And this one is from Chris Stricker. So let's check it out. You've Got It All, My Love. He says, I collaborated songwriting with the lyricist for verse development and wrote all the other parts and produced. I utilized musicians from Fiverr for bass and guitar. Awesome. And utilized Superior Drummer for drums. He's even cheaper than the drummers on Fiverr. So I write what comes out and don't attempt to sound like anyone else. Awesome, man. I am what I am. I am what I am. Okay. Here we go. Let's check it out. That's really cool that you sourced musicians online like that. I love when that happens. Here we go.
I'm stumbling through the fog where I've been wandering. Feels like I've been blind. I want to reach out for you. But you seem so far away.
Hey, Chris, let me know what you made this in and what kind of microphone you're using on the vocal. Here we go.
Like the Northern Star, home is where you are. I never will leave you wondering. Dark. dark's where I've been, and now my way shines clear. Wanna have you near, give you my hand. It's a long way ahead, just around the bend. Like the northern star, home is where you are. I will never leave you wondering. You've got my love, love. No matter what, I find my way to you, my way.
Cool. Thanks, Chris.
Like the northern star, home is where you are. It's where you are. I will never leave you wondering. You've got it. You've got my love. Love, love, love. You got it. You got it. All my love. Like the northern star.
Okay, awesome. Great track. Very cool. Yeah, I feel like that was really well made. Okay, I got some comments, and then I asked you what you were using DAW-wise and what you used on the vocal. So you said Pro Tools and SM7B and CLA Voice. So I want to look at the CLA Vocal plugin real quick. Find an image of it. Okay, so just give me an image. I just want an image. Why is it so hard? All right, here we go. Let me blow this up on my screen for you guys. Oh, hold on. Wrong button. Over here. I can't. Okay, no worries. So the faders left to right are like upper, lower, sub, rooftop bite, wall push, tight character, and then there's some effect stuff, spreader, delay, and then a chamber, and the other one's a hall, it looks like. So basically, I feel like the bass fader is down and the treble fader is up. That's what I remember from this plugin on this vocal, and it might be like a preset thing that you have going on. The reason I asked was it sounded like... like I remember a Logic preset sounding on vocals. So it's stealing away a lot of the body of the vocal, and it's adding some distortion and some top end that can get a bit grating at times. So that's what I was wondering. The most important thing to me on this was the vocal. So I would play around with like trying to even that back out, or even just starting from scratch on that vocal sound, because your SM7 should sound really good, and play around with... just how that vocal is balanced. Nice. I like your relationship, your analog to it, Karen. That's cool. Oh, and Valhalla Vintage version, which is awesome. That's great. Okay. So yeah, play around with the vocal tone a little bit more. I feel like it's a little bit thin, a little bit bitey. Let me just listen to a little bit more of that for a second.
Like the northern star.
Cool, yeah, and then there's some balance stuff going on where the guitars feel like they're really wide to me, like they're spread out a bit, and really loud, so louder than the rest of the stuff. The drums, especially on like that fill that you program that sounds really good, They don't feel like they're commanding power enough to me. So like, I feel like they could be a little bit more full range and bigger. Just look at whatever kind of processing you have going on with that. I know like the Superior Drummer stuff sounds pretty good. So make sure nothing's stealing away tone from any of that. And then, yeah, same with that vocal. Your SM7 should sound really good, and it feels like it's been like thinned out and a little bit bitey on it. The widening thing on the guitar, I don't think you need as much of that to make those guitars kind of speak like that. But yeah, I just play around with the balance of it and the thickness of those things. And let me listen to one more thing.
Long way ahead, just around the bend, like the northern star.
Yeah, so one other thing, like back on kind of like the headphone thing a little bit, somebody was just talking about the importance of listening the same to tracks on your headphones. So to get to know a speaker or a headphone or whatever, you have to listen to tons of music on it and all that. So that's just back on the headphone thing. But another trick, if you will, in relation to like using headphones and then checking on speakers and all that, listen to your speakers at very, very low level. Like if somebody was talking, it would be irritating you because you wouldn't be able to hear your mix, like super, super quiet. And that'll show you the stuff that's really loud in the mix is going to poke out, and you're still going to hear that pretty clearly, but everything else kind of fades in the back. And when I do that on this mix, the guitars are very loud, the vocals slightly behind that, and then the drums are kind of quiet and a little bit tiny behind them. So that might be a good thing to check out, is just what happens if you turn everything down. And you put something else in the chat about this possibly being the wrong mix that you uploaded. I don't see it off the quick scroll here from the top of it. So sorry. Oh, I think I clicked on the wrong track for upload. So this isn't mastered. May have that 8-inch or that 8-foot ceiling issue. And I have hearing loss in the 1 to 2K range in my right ear. Fought the backing vocals. Yeah, cool. So yeah, the 8-inch ceiling issue is huge. This sounds thin to me. So usually you don't have a buildup around there, but it's possible for sure. Also depending on where you have the speakers in the room, if you know, it's a, rectangle room, a square room, all of that kind of stuff. Square rooms, for anybody who doesn't know, square rooms are like the worst possible rooms because, the modes align perfectly because your halfway point in the width is the same as the length. And then if you add an 8-foot ceiling on top of that, it's one of the worst, mixing environments next to a pool, like being inside of an empty pool. So just something to check out. So the hearing loss thing, 1 to 2K in your right ear. Don't worry about that too much. I have differences in my ears for sure. And the Little Labs IBP, it's all wired in pretty tight, so I can't show you guys. But if you look up the Little Labs, not IBP, the monitor, if you look that up, you'll see that there's options on there to like, you can flop the left and the right, or you can listen to just the center or just the sides. And then that swapping the left and right thing is the first time I listened to that amp, Jonathan Little, the owner of Little Labs, was showing it to me on the show floor at NAMM, and he had an amazing playback system set up, and it was he had some Led Zeppelin on there, and I was listening and it sounded incredible. And then I flipped the switch to flop the left and the right, and I was like, what happened? Because what I was hearing on my right, I like, as soon as I flipped it, I heard it way better in my left ear. Then I flipped it back and I was like, wait, no, it sounds different again. And then I flipped it again and everything that was happening in my right ear was different. So I was aware I had a little difference in my right ear, but I never noticed it that drastically as when I was kind of flipping those back and forth. So I took the headphones off and Jonathan was like, what do you think? And I was like, I hate it. I was like, you just totally showed me that I have a hearing deficiency in my right ear. And Fab was with me. He was like, oh, he's joking. Like he's being facetious, but like it is an amazing headphone amp. I absolutely love it. The detail is incredible, but that pointed out to me that I have a difference between those ears. And we did a hearing segment on the channel. It was a live stream. It was like Andrew's hearing panel. I think Andrew Sheps did a hearing panel and talked with like Susan Rogers and some people that know absolutely insane amounts about hearing health and everything. And basically at the end of it, it was kind of just summed up that your ears and your mind sort of adapt to those differences and you figure it out. And as people get older and they have hearing loss, you'll still see, you know, Al Schmidt mixed, you know, well into the later years of his life, in the latest years of his life, he was still working and was making amazing records. And the man was making records for decades. So it's, you adapt to hearing loss, and that's where reference checks come in. Something that sounds bright to you is still going to sound bright to you. It's just things are dimmed a little bit and all of that. So I wouldn't worry about it too much, I guess, is like the very long-winded way of saying that. Very cool. Okay. The headphone amp, I'll put it in the chat, is the Little Labs Monitor. There we go. Awesome. Yeah, great, great vocal. I love the performance on it too. So cool. Karen felt like the whole thing could use some glue. So yeah, maybe check out some compression and stuff like that. But I'd check out the tonal things first and see what happens, and the balance things as well. I hope that helps. And yeah, thank you so much for submitting it too. Yes, Primetime says taste is more important than hearing. That couldn't be any more true. Absolutely. Great. So yeah, cool. I hope everybody had a good stream, and thank you all so much for coming and for submitting your mixes. This has been a blast. So reminder, we won't be here next week, but we'll be here in 2 weeks. If you're in the States and you have Labor Day, I hope you enjoy the day. And I will see you guys all next time. Keep an eye out on Friday for the new Andrew Sheps video. The compression typology explains every type of compressor and gives examples. And it's a great video that clears up a lot of stuff. So yeah, thank you again so much for everybody submitting stuff. Awesome. Thank you, Jeff. Yeah, thanks for being here. Thanks for submitting. Alpha, good to see you as well. Karen, everybody in the live chat, great to see you guys. All right, I will see you on the next one. Thank you so much. This has been a blast. All right, we'll see you. If I press the right button, I'll be signing off of this thing. I found my button. Here we go. See you guys.